to discuss it. Good morning, brethren. Good morning. Thank you, Mother Dorothy, for the time of prayer. Thank you, brethren, for joining in this morning. Shall we begin with a word of prayer? Loving Father, thank you so much again for the privilege of prayer. It's such a sweet hour of prayer to be with the brethren and pray. This morning, Lord, as we now do a lesson review, we pray that you may guide us, give us understanding, open our hearts, open our minds, that we may understand these important truths, the foundation of our hope, the return of our Lord Jesus, the second coming of our Lord Jesus. This is the blessed hope, Lord, that we as believers have. So, Lord, we ask that as we discuss this important lesson, our hearts may be lifted up and we may be drawn closer to you. May the Holy Spirit be our teacher. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll try and see if I can share the screen. Let me know if you can see my screen. Can you see my screen?
It's coming. Yeah. It's like...
It's still loading.
Yeah, it's loading. It says screen broadcast and it's flashing red. So I'm hoping that it's coming. It's loading. Yeah.
Okay. Can you see anything still?
Yeah, motivated by hope.
Wonderful. Let me just open from the, I think that was the one, yes, motivated by hope. That
yes.
Is, let's start from Sabbath, yes, motivated by hope. I just decided so you can see where I'm reading. So this is the lesson study, motivated by hope. Our key text, memory text comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Isaiah chapter 25 verse 9. Isaiah chapter 25 verse 9. Anybody was able to read it for us from KJV, from the King James Version? Some of the verses I might just highlight them there since they are there in the lesson study. Won't read all of the verses. Yes, please.
And it said, and it shall be in that day, lo, this is our God, we have waited for him and he will save us. This is the Lord, we have waited for him, we will be glad and rejoice in his salvation.
Amen. So what we're going to be looking at the lesson study this coming week, motivated by hope, our lesson is essentially centered on the second coming of Christ. This is one of the key aspects of our belief. It's a fundamental belief that we have as Seventh-day Adventists and as believers. You'll notice that the issue of the second coming has been dwelt upon. I think there on the introduction, you'll notice there's about 1,845 references to Christ's second coming in the Old Testament. Just in the Old Testament, 1,845 references. Then in the New Testament, you have about 300 references referring to the second return of our Lord. So it is a really key belief which is stated in the Bible. All right. Bear in mind that this quarter is centered on the great controversy. So when the authors are picking topics for discussions, they are pulling topics from the book, The Great Controversy. And this is one of the issues that you will not miss out when you read The Great Controversy. There's a chapter called Heralds of the Morning. So if you like, the lesson study for this week is like a shortened version of that chapter in the book, Great Controversy, Heralds of the Morning. It's a chapter speaking of the second return as one of our key beliefs, okay? So on Sunday, we're looking at the promise of his return. Promise of his return. Now, what the author states here is that when the Protestants moved, you know, when they accepted the doctrine of Protestantism, one of their key beliefs was the second return of the Lord Jesus. This was indeed a blessed hope for most of our Protestants. You hear names of John Calvin, Martin Luther, or John Wycliffe, they all spoke about the return of Christ. It's like that was the center of their hope. So they understood, just like any other believers in the Bible, and they believed in this key doctrine. Now, it's amazing that when these Protestants now moved to the promised land, well, so-called promised land, when they moved from Europe fleeing from persecution, they found the United States of America. The founding fathers of the United States of America were Protestants fleeing persecution from Europe. For some reason, when they moved to America, they started to relax, and the doctrine of the second coming started to fade away in their hearts. You know, they were now looking after gains. They were looking after prosperity. They wanted to prosper in this life. Until God had to raise William Miller. Now, I'm on Monday, where now the title is saying Anticipating the Time. Yeah, it's interesting that for some time, when the Protestant believers were in Europe, you know, studying the Bible as they believed in the literal return of our Lord Jesus. But it's for some reason, when they moved to America, that hope, that belief that they had, which was fresh, faded away, as I stated. And they started believing other things. I think the author there said this led to spiritual lethargy and an apathetic commitment to spiritual values. And it's so true. When you start to lose sight of the second return of Christ, your commitment, your devotion, will just, you know, start to melt down. You just start to lose interest. No wonder why this church is the church moving to America is in Revelation chapter 3. It is that church of Sardis, the church which is Jesus says you have a name that you are alive but you are dead. So at this point, because they'd lost their burning the blessed hope that burned, you know, within their hearts when they were standing for all these persecutions. Now, they only had a name, but they had given up on that important doctrine. Now, this is when now God had to raise some men to, again, study these things, and one of which was William Miller. I wanted to just read one of the statements there. It says, when Christ came the first time as babe in Bethlehem manger, very few people discerned his coming. But when he comes the second time, every eye shall see him come. Every ear will hear the trumpet blast of his return. Every human being on earth will behold his glory. We need not be deceived. The scriptures have made the events surrounding his return abundantly clear. But you would wonder, how could they miss such an important event? And so this is why God leads his servants to study these things. And William Miller was one of them. He started studying scripture. We are told his method of study that he would go verse by verse, as stated in Isaiah 28, verse 9. The method, this is the method of studying scripture. Here a little, there a little. So as he was studying the scripture, guess what he comes across? The doctrine of the second return of Christ. Now, what that doctrine does, again, it activates you. It gets you to burn because you now think, you know, our faith, if we were not expecting the second return of Christ, it would be in vain. So as now William Miller starts to study, he realizes that actually there were prophecies. He comes across the prophecy in Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. And to 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. He understood that this was a prophetic part of Daniel. And so he starts now studying the other prophecies that God had given in scripture, which were fulfilled. It comes across the prophecy that God had given to Abraham. It was fulfilled on time. He looks at the prophecy. I suppose he had seen the prophecy concerning the destruction of the antediluvians by water. God had fulfilled it. And so he goes through the prophecy of Jeremiah. He sees God had fulfilled that. So when he's studying Daniel 8, verse 14 now, which is the 2,300 days of Daniel, he understood that this was an important prophecy. And he knew that if God had fulfilled all the prophetic events in the past, this was one of which he definitely was going to fulfill. So he saw that it was such an important prophecy to study. And its fulfillment, he believed, was going to be the consummation of all things. The general understanding of the Christians at the time was that the earth was a sanctuary, and that by the cleansing of the sanctuary, this was the return of Christ, and the wicked and the earth will be made anew. That means the wicked will be burned up. This was their understanding, that you know God has to create all things anew at this second return of Christ. So he started preaching this doctrine. Now, so for this lesson only, we are going to be looking at this prophecy, the first part of it. Daniel chapter 8, obviously verse 14 tells us that unto 2,300 days. So the next chapter now, chapter 9, explains where Daniel, how Daniel was supposed to understand the breaking down of this prophecy. So Gabriel came back again to Daniel and tells him when this prophecy was going to be reckoned, when it was going to start. And he was told that from the decree to go and rebuild Jerusalem, which we understand was issued by Artaxerxes, king of Persia, in 457 BC. So the first 70 weeks of that prophecy was pertaining to the Jewish people. You start in 457 BC, the first 69 weeks or 483 years, they expire in the autumn of AD 27 when Jesus was baptized. And then the last 7 years of that prophecy, which takes us to 490 years, expire in AD 34 by the stoning of Stephen. That was the autumn of AD 34. In the midst of that week, Messiah was to be cut off. So, for the lesson this week, really, we are going to be dwelling on the second return of Christ as the consummation of our hope. In fact, Sister White in the book Great Controversy, she says this is a keynote that runs throughout the scripture from Genesis to Revelation. The doctrine of the second advent is one that gives us hope. The Apostle Paul says in Titus that this is the blessed hope of the return of our Lord Jesus. Now, I want to open up. I know we started slightly, I was trying to rush through so you can have the time to share your thoughts. So I understand because of time, maybe I'll just give a limit to a minute if there's any thoughts, anybody maybe might have a thought or a comment from Monday to or Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday. But essentially, that's what we're going to be looking at in our study this week. Wonder if there's any comments or any questions or any thoughts. I'll open that for to the floor. Probably I was going too fast, but I just wanted to share some scripture. If there's no thoughts, some scripture. There's so many scriptures in the Bible, but just to put notice that I didn't go through the whole 2300 day prophecy. It is such an important prophecy, but I should also state that the expiration of the 2300 day, obviously the event they had predicted was wrong, but it was such an important point in the believers calendar. 2300 day prophecy is where the Adventism rests on. This is, we believe, this is now, obviously, when they Jesus did not come, this is what caused the great disappointment. We talk about the great disappointment. It was because when this prophecy was well understood, they saw how God had fulfilled all the prophecies in the past. This is why they were in no doubt that on the 22nd of October 1844, Jesus was going to come down to collect or to receive his beloved children. Isaiah 25, verse 9, they repeated it. They were waiting for that event and for that glorious day of the appearing of the Lord in the clouds. They even prepared the ascension robes. They were waiting at some place, but Jesus did not come. They had sold everything they ever had. But when they now understood, went back to scripture, of course, we understand that's when they understood the doctrine of the sanctuary. That Jesus, yes, he had finished the first part ministration. The first ministration in the first apartment of the holy place. And he was now moving into the most holy place in the temple in heaven. There to begin the last part of his ministration in the Day of Atonement. So our understanding of the sanctuary is confirmed, just as it was in the type that day after day, the priests would minister in the outer, I mean, in the holy place. But once in a year, the high priest would go into the most holy place. And Jesus, as our high priest, He needs to do this work before he comes to receive his beloved children. Because the last part of this work, of this plan of redemption, has to do with investigation. The work of investigation is what's going on now. This is the cleansing of the sanctuary that is taking place now. But that would be the study for the next week. Up to this week, we're studying up to the AD 34, the first part. I think you can see the chart there. From 457 BC, 70 weeks take us to AD 34. And then you subtract 490 days from 2,300 days, which is the total number of this prophecy. You'll be left with 1,810 years. So if you add now 1,810 years from AD 34, you come to 1844, the autumn of the year 1844, which was 22nd of October 1844. Any thoughts at all? I didn't want to just speak. I suppose people can go now and study more. There's more scriptures in the Word of God in regards to the second return of Christ. This is our blessed hope. And we are actually called Seventh-day Adventists. The reason why God is called as Seventh-day Adventists, it's a God-given name. And it's a prophetic name. Amen. And it's what's
the last comment. Can you see the hands? I don't think you can.
Because, not when I'm using the sharing the screen. Sorry about that.
Yeah, okay. There is the Tatley twins, and there was Sister Hope. And there was a third hand. I don't know who that was.
Please, go ahead in that order.
Yes, good morning, everyone. I was looking at the Sunday's lesson where it says that the Protestant reformers and pilgrims who left Holland for the New World looked for the coming of Jesus, and for the second coming of Christ was a joyous event that they eagerly anticipated. John Wycliffe looked forward to the coming of Christ as a hope of the church. Calvin spoke of all reformers when he talked about the glorious return of Christ as all of all events most auspicious. I was looking at the word auspicious as well, which means promising, full of promise, bright, rosy, good, optimistic, hopeful, encouraging, opportunity, timely, well-timed, you know, fortunate. And, you know, and they really look forward to the coming of Christ, but as we see America now, we don't know. they didn't fear the first, second coming of Christ. They looked forward to it as the second coming of Christ as something glorious. We've got to keep that hope in our heart.
Amen.
Really hope we've got. We've got no other hope. There's nothing else to look forward to.
In fact, that song, "We Have This Hope That Burns Within Our Hearts." It is this hope of the return.
This is all we've got. We've got nothing else. If those that don't believe in Jesus, they've got no hope at all.
No.
No.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for those thoughts. Was there somebody else?
Just quickly. There was Sister Stoli. She had her hand up. I'll let her go.
Yes, please. Go ahead, Sister Stoli.
Thank you, Brother Desire. What I took away from the synopsis of this lesson is the attitude of William Miller. He's described as one who didn't have a college education, but the spirit that was in him, his desire to know, led him to go and dig. And my takeaway from this was the reminder and cement in my mind that there is nothing that is going to replace your personal study of the word, in order for us to know God, and yeah, in order for us to know God. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. William Miller was an earnest student of the Bible. His method is he could not read no faster than he could understand the passage at hand. You know, sometimes you hear people say, oh, I've read the Bible, I've finished it, and I've read it again. But the question is, have they understood? William Miller could not go faster than he could understand the passage at hand. So you don't move to verse 2 when you haven't understood verse 1. This is how thorough he was in studying the Bible, line upon line. Here a little, there a little. Amen. Was there any other hand?
Yeah, time is up. I just quickly say that we must never give a low value of ourselves.
Amen.
Regardless of your education, your background, anything, God can use you and me to do great exploits for Him. It is Him, and He can give you a talent. He can, if you desire something within your heart, pray for it and don't look at your education or your qualifications. God will qualify us. So let us allow this hope to keep burning within us. There is something special about the name Seventh-day Adventist.
Amen.
When I became, before I came, I became an Adventist. I Googled this name on my own. Something burned within me. I had this desire to know who are these people. Never heard of them before. And when I saw a picture of Adventists looking up to heaven. And then I saw a video of Sean Boonstra, the appearing, the second coming of Jesus. My heart just burned with desire to know who are these people with this
Amen.
Unique teaching. And I'm telling you, the Lord led me all the way. Let me cut that short because the time is up. Yeah. I don't want to go, but it is such a wonderful experience. And I'm sure some of you came from different backgrounds. You can understand how that felt. I just praise God for that. Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's a prophetic name and it stands as a rebuke. You know, when you call out yourself, or we call ourselves Seventh-day Adventists, it needs to remind us who we are and should be a rebuke. We are supposed to be watchmen in this world. And God gave that name, Seventh-day Adventists, because He knew the age in which this church was going to live. May God have mercy on us. Well, I don't think there was anyone burning last. Anyone burning, or there's no more hands? I think we'll end here, and I will now hand over to Sister Hope. Amen. God bless you, brother.
Sorry, before we go, I'm just urged to, you know, I'm lost for the word, but I'm urged to totally agree with my sister that was just there. It was what I was going to say. So the Lord wants to get this message across to us if He's got several of us bringing it to the table. And I just want to enforce it a bit more and bring it home a bit more. We need to look at the disciples. They were a prime example of who the people were. And we should never, ever underestimate ourselves. And in doing that, we're underestimating God. And in doing that, we're appeasing to Satan. The Lord showed me, and I'm going to say it again, when I was talking to myself about not going to church on the Sabbath, and I went to the Lord and He guided me to go, and later on that day He said, Paul, that wasn't you. And He told me that it was Satan, and He knew that it was going to be a big blow to me, and it has not left me, and it never ever will. That is going to stick with me forever. That we cannot trust our own judgment. This is the message. You cannot trust what you're telling yourself. You must take it to the Lord. He gives us all our strength. It's very important that we must look at ourselves as fit for the heavenly army, the as an angel in heaven. This is what we need to be fit for. And we need to, the Lord's not going to have the meek people that, you know, I don't mean to say meek. I mean to say, you know, those that are just going to sit in the background. We need to pray about this, that we all have the strength to do exactly what Jesus did, because he's our example. And I think we all need to pray about that and pray for each other. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Paul. Thank you, brethren. God bless you. Handing over now to Sister Hope.